Hear the sound of the wind. Let the roar of heaven begin. Can't stay silent, can't stay still when you show up in power, glory revealed. Oh, I can't stay silent, can't stay still when I feel the fire, feel the ground shake. Heaven invade! Heaven invade! There's freedom in this place. Every heart awakened, everything is changing now. Heaven invade! Broken hearts on the mend, all depression must end, all the shame and the fear run away when you're here. Starts to race and I can't contain the feeling of joy being in your presence. I can't help but dance, can't help but sing, and I don't really care what anyone thinks. My heart starts to race and I can't contain the feeling of joy being in your presence. I can't help but dance, can't
because he committed to clap to that song and he did the entire time. I love your commitment. Yeah, that's so funny. Good morning. We're so glad you're here. You braved the cold to come out. It's going to be a great morning of worship and celebration. And so we're so thankful that you're here. We love to connect with you all. And so if we don't know your name, we would love to. And so you can do that a couple different ways. You can scan this for the hello card. Or it's in the app, or there's cards out there, but we just would love to connect with you. So we encourage you to fill one of those out. So a few things about today. One, I've messed up the order. Yeah, rewind. No, we'll do it at the end. Okay, that's how this morning's going. I'm so sorry. I work on this all week, and then I'm the one that ruins it. Fantastic. Okay, a few things about today. One, there's no Grace student ministry, just with the cold and whatnot, and we have some families gone. So that will not be happening tonight, so don't venture out for that. And then next Saturday is a men's breakfast. And so if you are interested in that, it'll be here at the church at 8 a.m. on January 20th. And so we encourage you to come out, be a part of that for some good food, fun, and fellowship and stuff. Also, you have like 4 days to sign up for bowling. And so you can do that in the app. But they are, Stacy's putting together that teams and getting all that ready for our recreational ministry. So if you are interested in the bowling league, please do so. And a couple things in February that I'm just going to share. One is we have a pizza with the pastor coming up on February 4th. So if you are here and you're wondering maybe what your next step is, this is a great next step to meet some of the staff. And so we encourage you to sign up for that. And now, where's Chelsea at? Oh, where are you? I know. So we are bringing back our father-daughter dance. Yeah. So it was a great time and a great ministry, just a great outreach to bring people in and get to meet new people. And so that is going to be February 17th. So there's two QR codes up there. There's two links in the app. One is to RSVP. If you're a father, you want to bring your daughter, it helps us to plan. But the other one is to sign up to help and to be a part of that team with Chelsea and just to make that night happen. And so we just encourage you to get involved or to even see Chelsea. But that is... that's what's happening in February. And so if you were not here on Friday, it was a beautiful morning with our Crosspoint and WorkSource friends and staff. And so what we did was we had a baptism celebration. And so without further ado, get a glimpse of what happened on Friday. But if you were here, just the joy and just that space to be able to share and to celebrate that was just beautiful. So see Pastor Cody, Pastor Jeremy, if you want to know more about that. It's just a beautiful ministry and just to be a part of it. So church, will you stand with me? We're going to get ready and continue in our worship. We will also give back to God. So if you see baskets being passed, that's the reason why. But we are excited for this morning for what God is going to do. God, we're thankful that we can meet you any place, in the cold, in the warm, on the beach, in the snow. We're thankful that we've had this time right now to just come together. God, we're so thankful that you give us the privilege to make decisions to follow you, to live for you, and to know you more. God, that you give us free will, and so we get to make those decisions. And so we're thankful today for the decisions that were made on Friday, for those wonderfully made friends who worship you unabandedly. God, I pray that we would be people that would do that in our lives, not just here on a Sunday morning, but that as we go about our lives, that we just fix our eyes on you, that we see you in all things. God, I pray for this morning. I pray as Pastor Jeremy brings the message, God, that every word that comes out of his mouth is from you. I pray that through our song and through our giving and through our prayers, God, that everything points to a God who makes all things possible. God, will you empty us of anything that would be distracting to you? And will you fill us, and may we receive what you have in store for us today. God, I pray for this morning. I pray that what we do and say honors you. And I pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
The head that once was crowned with thorns is crowned with glory now. The Savior knelt to wash The one who wore our sin and shame, now robed in majesty, the radiance of perfect love, now shines for all to see.
Your name is victory.
doesn't take a trophy to make you proud. I'll never be more loved than I am right now. Going through a storm, but I won't go down. I hear your voice carried in the rhythm of the wind to call me out. You would cross an ocean so I wouldn't drown. You've never been closer than you are right now. You are Jireh. You are enough. Jireh. You are enough. And I will be content in every circumstance. Forever enough, always enough, more than enough. I don't wanna forget how I feel right now. On the mountaintop, I can see so clear what it's all about. Stay by my side when the sun goes down. More than you ask, think, or imagine, according to His power working in us. It's more than enough. It's more than enough.
This next song talks about the presence and faithfulness of God. This song reminds us that God is always near, even when we feel overwhelmed by the storms of life. It encourages us to keep our eyes fixed on Him and to trust that He will bring breakthrough and rain down His blessings. The lyrics speak of a hope that rises above our circumstances and reminds us of God's unfailing love and faithfulness. This song instills hope and inspires us as believers to keep pressing on, knowing that God has a plan and a purpose for our lives.
The word roaring as thunder with a new future to tell. For the dry season is over, there is a cloud beginning to swell. To the skies heavy with blessing, lift your eyes and offer your heart. Jesus Christ, open the heavens. Now we receive the Spirit of God. We receive.
We receive your rain. Kids, you are now dismissed. You can head out to the back, learn something good. And as they're making their way out, if you have yet to grab your elements of communion, you can do so. I want to start off by asking, has anyone ever made a plan and then at the last second, completely abandon that plan? A few people have. Well, I had something nice, neat, and pretty written down for communion. And then they sing that last song. And so if I'm going to be obedient, I got to completely abandon this plan and talk about what God just put on my heart. And so we celebrate, we gather this time for communion. And what we're celebrating is Jesus and God's love poured out on a cross. And he paid the penalty. I mean, I know this is all basic stuff, right? But when you sit and you think about it, he took my place. He took your place on a cross. And he paid a penalty that we could never pay. And if that's where the story ended, it wouldn't be as good, right? But we know that 3 days later, he got up and he walked out of that grave. And so I just want to talk about that power for a moment. Chelsea sang that first line, and it talked about a dry season. And I know we've all been there. We've all been in this period, this dry season, where we ask, where are you, God? And God's here. And see, they were going through a dry season long, long time ago, and they needed saving. And Paul says at about that time, God sent Jesus down because he loves us. And we needed a Savior. And when the time was right, after his earthly ministry, Jesus went to a cross. And then again, he rose. And there's power in that. And I just want to share that with you this morning. And that's what was just laid on my heart, that you're going to go through a dry season, but there's a cloud. And God is raining his love down. He already did, and he still does every single day. We just have to ask. We have to receive it. We absolutely just have to receive it. We have to ask God, thank you. Thank you for sending your son Jesus to die on a cross for me. Thank you that he didn't stay there, that he rose again. Because that power that raised him from the grave is with you today, sitting right there in that chair. Right up on this stage, that's the same exact power. I'm thankful for that this morning. I'm thankful that he laid something different on my heart than what I had written down. On the night he was betrayed, Jesus took bread, and after giving thanks, he broke it. And he said, this is my body, broken for you. Eat in remembrance of me. And after supper, he took the cup and he said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." Father, I just want to say thank you today. I want to say thank you that you know when we're in a dry season. God, sometimes you put us there to teach us things. And I'm thankful for that. I'm thankful for when my cup is empty, that you fill it up again, that you make it overflow, that you sent Jesus and that he died on a cross to pay my penalty. I could never do it, and you knew that. I thank you for the resurrection. I thank you that Jesus didn't stay dead, that he rose again, and that that same power lives within me and with all of us. Thank you, God. We love you. We just want to glorify your name. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you. Amen. Hey, why don't y'all stand up real quick? Will y'all stand up? Go ahead. Why don't you all look to your left and your right? Go ahead, look, look, look. Okay, go find somebody to shake hands with. Go ahead, move around. It's cold out. Just trying to keep you warm and active. It's like freezing pipes. I don't want your pipes to freeze up.
I could play Heart and Soul.
Amen. You can be seated today. Amen. Amen. That's just a preacher trick when they really don't know what they're going to say and they're trying to buy time. So anyway, hey, I'm glad y'all are here. I'm glad you made it out. There were churches, Nazarene churches that were canceling church 2 days ago. We don't really cancel church. I don't know why people cancel church. We're adults. If you want to get out, get out. If you don't want to get out, stay at home, watch it online. I don't know. I mean, I don't care. I don't. There's people watching today, more people, and that's great. But for us, we like to get together. Hey, I want to talk to you about some something today. My voice is apparently changing. We've kind of talked about for a couple of years around here as kind of staff, and we really talked about this a little bit when we first got here. But 4 years ago. Almost, let's see, in a couple of weeks, I guess, we'll have been here for 4 years, and this place looks completely different than what it looked like 4 years ago. Most of you 4 years ago weren't sitting here. If you weren't sitting here 4 years ago, would you just raise your hand if you were not sitting here? Okay, put your hands down. How many of you were sitting here 4 years ago? That just blows my mind again. One of the things that our district superintendent, who oversees the Nazarene churches in this geographical area, told our church board was, when you decide to do this, the odds of you being on the church board in 3 or 4 years is pretty good that you won't be on the board anymore. So if you're going to make this change, I hope that you're okay with that. And they were all okay with it. And so this time around, there's still one person that's on our church board that was on our church board when we got here. And there's two people that were here 4 years ago, and the rest of our church board 4 years ago were not here. And I think it's a really great testament to the people that were here 4 years ago, that they were willing to make some changes that were uncomfortable, that willing to take some risks and gamble in a smart way, but in a way that was going to make an impact in the community. And this is evidence that it has. And so I'm very grateful for that. One of the things that we knew that we were going to have to do during that process was to relaunch or to restart different ministries and take a fresh eyes at all kinds of different areas in the church. And so basically we got rid of everything at the beginning, which COVID helped that greatly. It was beautiful for us. So I know COVID is kind of a mixed bag with churches. Most churches, conferences that I go to, all the pastors have all these horror stories about COVID. I don't have a horror story. Nobody got mad at me during COVID, even though we were relaunching a church, because COVID did all the work for the pastor. So it took all of the heat away. And now the heat starts coming back at me now, because we're going to continue to make changes. Because I believe that as a good follower of Christ, that everything is always on the table. Amen? Everything we do is always on the table. Just because we've done it for 30 years doesn't mean we're going to keep doing it that way. Because what happens is it doesn't work anymore. And so you can think of companies nowadays that are not in existence because they never changed. I think I've used Kodak as an example. Kodak, you can now start to find some different things that they're putting out because somebody bought up the name. But Kodak, that most of us grew up with film, is no longer in existence because they didn't change. They didn't want to change. It was their model. It's what they did. And so what we have to do as a church is continue to change the way that we do things and take a fresh eyes and a fresh look at everything that we do. And so today what I really want to talk about is kind of where we're at with one of our, I think, our key ministries here, which are children, teens, and young adults. And one of the things that I've come to realize across the years is that probably in the last 20 years is that model of children's ministry, of teen ministry, of student ministry has changed drastically. And it's really changed dramatically. And one of the things I've also realized in a Nazarene world that I live in is that we're usually about 20 years behind what everybody else is doing. We just are. I don't know why. Now, I wouldn't say that's necessarily true for this church. I think we're kind of pushing the envelope within our own denomination. But I think that we've got to start catching up. So if you've got your Bible app today, open that up. There's a couple of scriptures I want to use. If you go to the Bible app and you go down to the right-hand side, I think it says events, and it should be the first one on there. It says Grace Community Live. Ooh, we should change the worship experience name to Come to Grace Community Live. Okay, whatever. Okay, so I want to talk about starting with a mission. That's what I want to talk about. So 4 years ago, we had to decide what we wanted to do. What do we really want to accomplish? What is the role of the church? What is our role? Is it to get people together and to kind of just hang out and be together and praise the Lord and kind of do the things that we want to do? Are we doing all of these things for us? Are we just kind of waiting on the Lord to come, or waiting to die and go to heaven? By the way, I was extremely frustrated again this week with death. Man, death isn't it frustrating? Sorry, I'm going to run up a rabbit trail for a minute. Jerry went to be with heaven to be with the Lord in heaven this week, and I think 4 funerals we've been involved in. Well, 3. There'll be 4 in 3 or 4 weeks. It's just a lot. But I'm so grateful for Jerry's life, and I'm grateful for his spirit, and I'm grateful that he's just a faithful man. And so his reward is here. And so we're grateful for that. But, man, death it sucks. Can I say that? Is that okay to say? I'm going to say it anyway. It sucks. And so it's the circle of life, and I'm just glad that we know Jesus, and I'm glad we've got a Savior. Okay, I'm back on track. So we had to start with what was our goal. What are we trying to accomplish? And I've been in different all kinds of different churches. We've been in all kinds of different places. And there are some churches that we've been in that don't want to change anything. They like what they're doing. They don't want new people. They like where they're headed. And I don't work very well in an environment like that. But they like where they're going, and where they're going is into a ditch. But they're okay with that because there's safety in the ditch. They know what the ditch feels like. They know what it looks like. There's comfort in that for them. And so that's kind of where they want to be. But their mission is way different than ours. So our mission is on the wall. Can somebody tell me what our mission is? That's it. It's introducing people to the real Jesus. And so we had to figure out what that looked like for us. What does that mean? Well, we want to tell people about Christ. We want to help tell people about the Jesus that we find in the New Testament. Do we always get it right? No. Sometimes we still get some things in there that are probably our thoughts, our opinions, but boy, we really work towards that. And we want to do that in every area of our church, our student ministry, our children's ministry, our young adults, our senior citizens, middle-aged people. We want every single area to have an element, if not the element, of just telling people about who Jesus is, because he's the one that changes lives and changes generations. So with that said, we then had to take a fresh look at our ministry to children and to teens and to young adults. And so this Deuteronomy 6:4-9 is the scripture that I kind of want to look at. It says, "Listen, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord alone. And you must love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, and all your strength. And you must commit yourselves wholeheartedly to these commands that I am giving you today. Repeat them again and again to who? To your children. Talk about them when you are at home, when you are on the road, when you are going to bed, when you are getting up. Tie them to your hands. Wear them on your foreheads as reminders." We could have had some Jewish friends come today, and they would have literally had some prayer boxes tied to their foreheads. They take this very literal. "Write them on the doorpost of your house and on your gates." You've been to Hobby Lobby? They follow that right there. It's written scripture all over the place. And probably in your homes, it's written on the wall. Jeremiah 29:11 or Romans 8:28 or something is on your wall. At John 3:16. So what I want to look at today is, how are we doing here? How are we doing as it compares to those three areas in our church as we look at Deuteronomy 6:4-9? Are we repeating them? Are we repeating them again and again to our children? Are we talking about them as parents when we're at home and when we're on the road? Are we going to bed and are we getting up talking about Christ and what Jesus is going to do for us today? Are we teaching our children where to find Christ at in a world that's lost and broken? Are we tying them to our hands? Are we wearing them on our foreheads? Are we writing them on our doorpost and on our house gates? Are we doing that? And so one of the things that we had to kind of really just take a look at is how does the church go into a relationship with parents? Because what I've learned in 20 plus years of ministry is what parents that come into a relationship with Christ don't know is how to do this. They just don't. They hardly have a good time feeding themselves. So to be able to feed your children is really hard. So then what happens is it then becomes the responsibility of the church to do that. But we really don't want that responsibility. We want to partner with parents to do that. That's really what we want to do. We want to partner with you. So we want to teach you how to do that. We want to give you tools how to do that. We want to give you opportunities to be able to do that. So that's really where we're headed. So really what we're looking at here at Grace Community is a switch from children ministry, student ministry, and young adults, which, again, all of those things will still exist. But it's really a holistic point of view of taking that we're looking at the whole family. So it's really a family ministry. And then we've got to figure out what that looks like. So I know when we made the change to bring kids in here for worship that, a few of you, of course, nobody comes to me because I'm the preacher and nobody, you just, you'd rather talk about me at lunch, but that's okay. I used to talk about my own pastor at lunch, so I get it. But, you know, it'd be better if you just talked to me. But some people didn't want to do that. You didn't like that idea. And of course, Jeremy tries to listen and then he'll listen to you and then he's like, well, I don't really care what they think anyway, because this is what we're doing because I know it's going to work. Right? I know it's going to work. I've seen this. We've seen this model. And so what we wanted to do is we wanted our children in here during worship to learn to do what? Okay, this isn't rocket science, is it? Now, I didn't pull up the pictures, not because I didn't send them to Sandy to send to Eric, but as I was sitting up here, again, I always talk about the perspective up here and your perspective from down there, is we get to see things. And every once in a while, somebody captures a photo of something that happens, and I don't have it up there. But there's a couple of great photos that you all could have seen. They were on Facebook, and we could have taken multiple of them because it happens regularly, where our teens come down and they pray for each other, where our children now have started coming down during worship, and there's no adults around. They are children that come down and pray for children. Now, how did they learn that? It got modeled to them, didn't it? And it got modeled to them in this room. And so is it a pain in the rear end sometimes to have children in the room that make a lot of noise? Well, I don't think so, because it means the church is alive. And we get to teach them what it means to love Christ and how to worship. And we get to, they get to see communion, and they get to see worship, and they get to see adults with their hands in the air. And they know that's okay. And just to be real frank with you about this, and I'm not bashing anybody, and you can think that I am, but there are times when I've been to different churches where they'll have a youth group or children's activities or students, and you can tell that they're not what I would call a worshipful program. They love Jesus, okay? They love God. I'm not saying that. They love Christ. They're reading their Bibles and they're doing devotions, but they don't really worship well. And the reason they don't worship well is then when you get into the sanctuary as the pastor and you look at the adults worshiping, you're like, oh, now I understand why their children don't worship. Because it's not being modeled. It's a bunch of deadbeats that are up there singing about the Lord, but they're sucking on lemons. And so what we want to do, and we all have bad days, I get it. That's not what I'm talking about. But if the culture of your church is not one of worship, is not one of prayer, is not one of service, is not one of community, then your children will learn none of those things. They're not just going to learn it from you. They're not just going to learn it from us. We've got to work in tandem. Amen? To disciple and to bring up our children. And so what we had to do is we had to figure out, what does family ministry look like? So I want to tell you really what a family ministry is. So family ministry is a partnership between the church and the home. It's just a partnership between us. In a perfect world, and we've talked about this, and I don't know, I'll just be real honest, it takes money to do ministry, okay? It takes money to build a business. It takes money to feed your children. Money seems to make the world go around. I don't think that's a bad thing to say that. I'm just going to say it. And so if we were a church of, let's say that our budget was, whatever, $500,000 rather than $300,000, I would go out and I would hire a couple of full-time people to do some things that we can't do as a staff because we're stretched to the things that we need to get done. So one of those things is we would just get together with teens, students, students, children, and young adults, senior citizens, life groups, the preacher, Sunday morning, Wednesday night, and everything would work in tandem. Everything. Everything would be focused on one topic, one subject, one area. And so that way, when you walk out of church, you can then go down and have a conversation with your kids about what you talked about that day, because we were all on the same page. We all used the same scripture, etc., etc., etc. Now, that's hard to do. That's super hard to do. Big churches can do it because they've hired people to get some of those things done. We do our best to do some of those things, and that's where we want to shoot for. We're going to have a hard time getting there sometimes, but we need to work in tandem that when we're talking about love, or we're talking about the fruit of the Spirit, or we're talking about whatever it is, that our different areas are also talking about the same thing. Why? Because we want to go back to Deuteronomy, and we want to be able to repeat them to each other. Again and again, we want to be able to have a conversation about them when we are at home, when we are in the car, when we go to bed, and when we get up. Amen? So we want to try to do that. And that takes a lot of coordination. It takes a lot of moving pieces. It takes a lot of volunteers. It takes a lot of cooperation. Amen? It takes a lot of teamwork. It takes a lot of people saying, you know what, I don't know if I necessarily agree with that, but I'm going to give you a shot, and I'm going to get on board, and I'm going to head on down the road with you rather than work against you. That's the kind of cooperation that I'm talking about, because I think that our children from whatever, from 0 to 22, it hangs in the balance. So there's a statistic, easy for you to say, 95% of the followers of Christ in the United States that are now adults that follow the Lord, okay, 95% all found the Lord before they were 18. 95%. That means that 5% of the people that are now followers of Christ found him after they were 18. That's why this area in churches is so important. It's why any church in town you could go to, and all of them are going to tell you that one of the things that they want to get better at in their key initiatives in their church is family ministry or ministry to children and teens. Every church is going to tell you that. I'm just going to tell you, even the ones that have no teens are going to tell you they want to reach teens or they want to reach young people. They don't know how, and they're not willing to put their money where their mouth is, but that's what they want to do. I'm telling you, we're going to try to put our money where our mouth is. I'm telling you, we're going to try to make some changes and some switches around here, and we're going to head into a direction that I think is what the Lord's calling us to do. The second thing is this: a family ministry focuses on kids, parents, and leaders. It focuses on kids, parents, and leaders. And I think that's super important. So one of the things that I always have a hard time with are expectations. You ever have a hard time with that? You know, when you lead something and you're the leader of something, it's very hard for me to sit down with people, especially that are volunteers, and say, these are my expectations of you. And if you can't meet the expectations, that's fine. I'm not upset with you, but you're not going to be able to do whatever that is. See, that's hard for me to say because in a lot of churches, you're just looking for warm bodies. Now, that's not the right way to do it. But it's the reality, though, that a lot of us grew up with is that you're just looking for people that aren't creepy to work in the children's area, okay? That literally, that's what you're looking for. They can pass a background check and they're not creeps. Well, I think that maybe the standards that the Lord set for us are a little higher. So it's one of the things that I have a hard time with sometimes telling people are expectations. And so as leaders, though, in the church, you know, I have an expectation that you're in a worship service. That's an expectation that I have. And I don't think I clearly communicate that to everybody because most people, you know, come in, come out, come in, come out. But if we've got an area that you know, you're never in church because you have to volunteer for said area, then I'm not, as the leader, I'm not helping you. You've got to be in the culture of the church. See, this is the culture right here. This is where it starts. Now, it flows out from here, but the culture of Grace Community, for better or for worse, and it wasn't on purpose, but it happens right here. This is what changed. And so the culture has to permeate all of these different areas of the church. But to do that, you've got to be in here. You've got to be in this space. Because what we want to do as a staff is protect your worship time. Amen? Because family ministry doesn't just focus on the kid. It focuses on mom and dad. It focuses on leaders. We want you to have some expectations that we know that you can meet, and then we want to help you to meet them. And so to do that, then we have to have people that say, you know what, I would love to participate in the children's area. I would love to do that. I'd love to do that twice a month. I'd love to do that once a month. Whatever that looks like, use me. Put me to work. And some people will say, and I've been one of them, well, gosh, I really don't want to work with kids. Well, there are things down there. Well, you don't have to necessarily work with kids. You can work with parents. You can work with the adults. Check in. I mean, we have people that check people in. I mean, you're not necessarily working with kids. You're working with adults, but you've got to be sane and you've got to be kind and, you know, you've got to be empathetic and all of those things, you know, because it's a new mom and she wants to make sure that her baby's in a good spot, you know, and you're going to have to take her down there and show her around, show her the cameras, tell her everybody's background check, show her the windows on the door, show her all the things and the bells and the whistles. And, you know, you can do that because you're really good at that. Because you're also a mom that's empathetic. Those kind of things. But we want to pour into our kids, our parents, and our leaders. We also want to give, like teenagers, we want to give them opportunities to lead. But again, to have opportunities to lead, it's got to be modeled. It's got to be modeled. It's got to be taught. And I don't have all of the sayings, but one of the things that I've learned in some different training things, and I don't have the cute little, you know, the little eight things that they say, but if I want you, if you want to go do, so if I want to go work on a house with Felix, and I don't know how to use a tape measure, okay? I mean, I can use one, but I'm going to count the number of spaces over because I'm one of those guys, okay? I mean, I know what a quarter, a half, I know those, but, you know, when you get into eighths and sixteenths, like, I'm out. Like, I'm not a finished carpenter. I'm not a carpenter at all. But I can count over the little lines on the thing, okay? But if I don't know how to do that, I'm going to go to Felix, and I'm going to say, Felix, I need you to teach me how to use this. Felix would be an idiot if he said, here you go, and he showed me once, and here's how you do it. Now, I want you to go out, and I want you to build a table over here. I mean, he'd be a moron to do that. What? That's my end. And so then he would teach me. And then what we would do is we would build a table together. Okay, we'd build it together, or let's say a bookcase. I like bookcases. We'd build a bookcase together, and he'd let me do a couple things, but he's not going to let me do much. He's going to show me. We're going to measure. He's going to teach me. Now, the next time we build a bookcase, he's going to give me a little bit more responsibility, but we're going to build several bookcases before he says, Jeremy, I want you to go over there and build a bookcase, and I'm not going to be anywhere around, okay? I mean, but we have to give people opportunities to do that, but we just don't cut people loose. We just don't say, well, there you go. That's not how we roll. That's not how we want to roll, okay? Those are the things that we want to get better at. Now, the last part of this, family ministry. A family ministry aims to develop disciple-making disciples. If you've been around here for very long, you realize, and maybe you haven't thought about this, that we like to create opportunities for people to hear about Christ inside the church and outside the church. I mean, if you were here on Friday, you would have seen again, I think there were, Olivia, where are you? Is she here? Oh, yeah, that is Olivia. Hi, Olivia, how are you? How many people did we have? Because you counted, I think. Around 106 people were here on a Friday. Most of those were the clients of Cross Point and WorkSource, and 29 of them were baptized, and the other folks came to watch, and there were a couple of volunteers, and there were some staff, and there were a couple people that just came to see what was going on. And I told you all that to tell you, I took too long, and now I don't know why I told you all that. What was I talking about? Disciples making disciples. Yeah. Well, anyway, that's good information for you, isn't it? It's okay. It's fine. It'll come back around. But so I'll just keep talking. Disciples making disciples. So what we want to do is we want to create opportunities for our kids. Oh, I know what I was talking about. Thank you. So you realize that that's what we're about. That's what we like. So we like the Cross Point, the WorkSource. We like to go over to Autumn Fields. We like to go to Emmanuel. We like the bus. Those are the things that I think that are really key. But here's the really important piece, and most of us in this room didn't get this, and I think it's time for us to teach our children this, is this. It is not the responsibility of the church to always create opportunities for you to go share about Jesus. It's really not. It's not our job. I mean, look in the New Testament. I mean, Jesus didn't do an Easter egg hunt to get all these people. I mean, he taught 12 guys, essentially, and there were more, but he taught 12 guys to how to make disciples. Here's what I want you to do. Did you know that the disciples had disciples? Okay, so then the disciples told their disciples on how to do this. And then they didn't create all these big opportunities. I mean, people probably weren't getting saved, if you will, in the temple. Amen? People were getting saved at Zacchaeus' house. People were getting saved at Sol del Mar, not El Toro. They were getting saved at Sol del Mar. People were getting saved as they walked the streets. People were getting saved in the marketplace. People were coming into a relationship with Jesus as they heard about Jesus. Amen? Like, they weren't doing this all the time as a group. They were going out as they went, Matthew 28, as you go, tell people about me. Teach them the commands that I'm teaching you, and I'll be with you. While you do this, I'm going to be with you, but I need you to go do this. And so what we want to teach our children is that they can go out in their schools today and tell people about Jesus. They don't need mom and dad along with them. They don't need even the church, if you will, alongside of them physically. Yes, we're behind them. Yes, we're beside them. Yes, we're cheering them on. But they can do that. But we've got to be able to teach them. So here's the mission statement that we came up with for family ministries. It's this: to create experiences for families to be introduced to the real Jesus through what? Through worship, which I think we're getting that well, prayer, God's word, service, and community. To create experiences for families to be introduced to the real Jesus through worship, through prayer, through God's word, through service, and through community. I think if we did those five things and we did them really well, you would see an influx of students from zero to 22, 23, 24, 25 that this church hasn't seen in a long, long time. Because, again, what we want to be able to do is we want to be able to help you as parents to then help your children to be really good disciples and to be good disciple makers. So one of the things I hear often is people will talk about, I don't know where to start in the Bible. Okay, I don't know where to start. How many of you have said that to yourself? Just be honest. Yeah, I don't know where to start. Because it's very confusing. I have a chronological Bible that's kind of cool because, you know, that's not chronological. You know, it's not all put together in exactly how all this went together, you know, time and a timeline. It's all very different. It can be very confusing. I mean, any other book I pick up, I start at the very beginning of the book. I don't know. That just kind of sounds normal. But we don't necessarily do that with our Bibles. Well, again, as the church, we want to offer you opportunities to come into a class as a parent to say, here's even what the Bible is. How many books are in the Bible? There's 66. Well, why? How did they get in there? What is the good news? What does Revelation mean? Why is it Genesis to Revelation? What does that mean? What do you mean that God resides in my spirit? Like, what does that mean? We say those things and they just flow off our tongue like everybody knows what we're talking about. But boy, wouldn't it be nice for our parents to be in a space to be able to ask these questions and to be able to learn a little bit more so when their kids say, hey, I don't understand this, you don't have to always say, well, I don't know. Now, times you will say, I don't know. I have no idea. Were there dinosaurs in the Bible? Well, let's find out together, because I think that there were. I'll just tell you the answer. I think that there's some words in there that would say, yeah, I think I can make the case. You know, was the world really created in 7 days, or was it longer? Like, again, I think we can give you some help in that area. But what that means is that you have to participate with us, right? That means you have to be part of the solution. So I'm just introducing this today, and I want you to know that we are stretching ourselves this year, okay, financially. Now, it's not a lot, but we are moving Cody Miles into Pastor Cody Miles into the position of the family ministries pastor that will oversee children's, that will oversee teens, and that will oversee young adults. It doesn't mean he's doing all the work, okay? What's happened is that with the help of Sandy, Cody has developed a really good team for Crosspoint, WorkSource, and for our Emmanuel and Autumn Fields. And so they'll still be involved in that, and he'll still help in that area. But those are not necessarily ministries that just run themselves. But because of the volunteers the culture that's been created there, he can kind of move in into another area. So just so you know, we're trying to pay him a big $100, no, $125, because we have to take taxes out of that. We were hoping to at least see $100 a week. So, you know, so again, and if you, right, it's legitimately, if you want to make a difference in the lives of children, you know, mark that. Put Cody Miles on there, and we can help him to, he can call into work more often than he does already. Right? Yeah. Absolutely. He's a security guard. And I think one of these, is that what you do? Is that what I would say? Security guard? He's a babysitter at the prison. Right. Yeah, okay. Yeah, him and Troy, wherever Troy's at. Yeah, babysitters at the prison. And one of these days, you know, I think he'll pastor a church and quit that job and give away all those great state benefits. Yeah, there you go. Good, good. So legitimately, but again, and so we're going to make some changes. There's going to be some changes. And I want to be, and I'm not blowing smoke. The people that have led those ministries for all of these years from whenever Southside Church of the Nazarene started, I mean, all of them have been so faithful and have poured into people and have poured in and have done things that wouldn't have gotten done otherwise. And I am grateful for that, and I am thankful for that. And so I've always tried to be real careful. I got in trouble with this in my last church when I corrected the pastor that had been there for 40 years that talked about sanctification and that once you're sanctified, you can't sin. That's just stupid. And so I had to correct that. Well, then I had people come to me and you're always saying what he did was wrong and we take offense to that. Well, I don't care. It was wrong. Now, I'm not saying anything we've done around here is wrong. I'm just saying what we've got to do, though, is we've got to make a switch. We've got to tweak things. I always think of it this way, and I heard this not too long ago. If I'm going from here to, let's say, the Hobby Lobby in Champaign, and I drew a straight line from here to the Hobby Lobby in Champaign, and I stayed on that line, I'm going to go right there. If I get one degree off, and that's only, 35 miles? If I get one degree off, I'm going to be way far away from the Hobby Lobby. I mean, I'm going to be nowhere close. I'm going to be out in the middle of a cornfield somewhere, and I won't even be able to see Champaign-Urbana. Just one degree off. But that's what we're talking about. We're talking about making some degree changes. And we have to do that as the church. And so I am grateful for cooperation. I'm grateful for team players. I'm grateful for people that always don't agree, but always don't have to voice it. I'm grateful if they do voice it, they come to me or Sandy and Cody and they voice it. Because you can voice it to everybody else, but none of those people have the authority to change anything. So you might as well just go to the three people that do. Amen? And then things that we need to talk about with our church board, which we've talked about this with our church board, not at nauseam, but at good length. Those are the things that then we get together and we say, gosh, what do you think about this? Talking about kids in the sanctuary, like we've talked about that. Now, we all agree, like there's not one person that's pushed back and said, well, we think that's stupid. It's wonderful. I mean, it is great. You go to a lot of churches in town, there are no kids in the building that age. So when there are kids that make a little, see, somebody's crying right now, right on cue. It's better than cell phones going off, millennials or Gen Xers or baby boomers. It's the baby boomers. I'll teach any baby boomers my parents' age how to put your phone on silent, okay? Drives me crazy. It's not the old people. It's not the young people. It's people my parents' age, isn't it? And then they get on a restaurant and they're talking. Drives me nuts. That's rude. You just stop talking. You don't have to answer just because somebody calls. There's a little decline button on there. I won't tell you that. I've been in funerals where people answer their phones. It's just weird to me. Sorry, that was a little that was a major rabbit trail. So anyway, that's what we're doing. So if you have any thoughts, okay, good thoughts on things that pertain to family ministry, talk to Cody. And I mean that. And I don't mean that. Don't come to him with goofy things. I'm talking about things that are solution things, the things that are visionary, things that are big, things that are grand. How do we reach kids in our community? How do we reach parents of those kids in our community? What do we need to do to make our family ministry something that people, when they say the word Grace Community, that they say, gosh, they've really got it going on over there with families. How do we do that? And if you have those thoughts, you talk to Cody about it. Because Cody will listen to you, and he may say you're crazy, okay? But 9 times out of 10, what I've learned and Cody's learning and we're all learning is that we're not the smartest people in the room. It's when we work together as a team. It's when we get together as a team and we get to bounce things back and forth off of each other. And then at the end of the day, somebody has to make a decision, right? That's why we hire pastors. That's why we hire administrators. That's why we do that. And then you take all those things into consideration and then you head in that direction. And so that's what we're trying to do around here. I want to pray with you, and then we've got about, 8 to 10 baptisms, and so we're going to celebrate that and be excited about that, and then we'll get you out of here. Father, thank you so much for an opportunity to be in your presence today. You're a great God. Lord, ministry is a challenge. we say that in 2023 or 4, whatever the year is, but Lord, 2,000 years ago, talk about a challenge. I mean, this is really nothing. We're not going to lose our lives. I mean, not here. There are places in the world where people will. But, Lord, we're not going to lose our lives if we, make a switch or make a one-degree change. We're not going to lose our life over that. But yet, Father, we live in 2024, and there are things that are challenging that maybe weren't the same challenges 2,000 years ago, but yet they're challenging and they're important, and it's worth taking a look at. Father, I pray for our parents that are in this room. I pray, Father, that you would put in them a desire to get closer to you, a desire to learn what it means to be a follower of Christ. And, Father, we're never going to arrive. Never will we have arrived until we've taken our final breath and we stand in your presence. But, Father, we want to do the best that we can with the resources that we have, with the gifts that you've given to us, to point our children towards Jesus, to point each other towards Christ. And we are thankful that we're in a community of people that give the pastors and the board and staff the opportunity to do that without really too much pushback. Father, I'm grateful for that. That's not normal. And so, Father, I don't want to say this is a big research and development lab, but, you know, it really kind of is. We continue to research. We continue to try to develop things here in Tilton, Illinois, that will make an impact for generations to come. And we are grateful to be in a space that allows us to do that. Father, we love you and we praise you. Thank you for each and every person that will be baptized today. I'm grateful for their lives. I'm grateful for their testimony that they want to stand before their church and say, I'm going to follow Christ and I'm going to make him head of my life and my family's lives. And so we're grateful for that today, Father. We just ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Christ is my firm foundation, the rock on which I stand. When everything around me is shaken, I've never been more glad that I put my faith in Jesus. 'Cause he's never let me down. He's faithful through generations. So why would he fail now? He won't. I still got joy in chaos. I've got peace that makes no sense. So I won't be going under. I'm not held by my own strength, 'cause I've built my life on Jesus. And he's never let me down. He's faithful in every season. So why would he fail now? He won't.
Hey, welcome, Abby Mobley. How old are you?
10.
10 years old, make a decision for Christ. Isn't that awesome? Yeah.
Child of God, on my worst day,
And this is Brenna. Welcome, Brenna. She is so excited to serve the Lord. She's excited to tell all of you and declare that she is a child of God.
I'm a child of God. On my worst day, I'm a child of God. Oh, every day is a good day, and you're the reason why.
Hey, we got Tracy. Woo! Are you excited? Nervous. Oh, no need to be nervous. Yeah, you don't have to talk or anything. This is Dawn's sister, if anybody doesn't know her. I feel like ever since Jeremy started an ice cream shop, we've just had legacies of people just coming in and getting saved. So that's awesome.
I already
see it.
I already know it.
I'm so blessed. I'm so blessed. Got this heartbeat in my chest. No, it doesn't matter about the rest. I'm a child of God. On my worst day, I'm a child of God. Oh, every day is a good day, and you're the reason why.
The kids didn't know they were in the splash zone today, so. Hey, welcome Jaron. Hey, Jaron's one of our volunteers with the teen group, and he's learning the sound system back there. And just to see his growth is pretty amazing. And he likes Bobby Caldwell, if anybody cares.
No, it doesn't matter about the rest. But I got you, Lord, I'm so blessed. On my best day, I'm a child of God. On my worst day, I'm a child of God. Oh, every day is a good day. And you're the reason why.
I'm so blessed,
got this heartbeat in my chest. No, it doesn't matter about the rest.
Hey, this is Diana Diaz, and her and Joseph belong together. She claimed him this morning while we were chatting, so that's good. Come on down here. No, you're fine. That's okay. I can't see without my glasses either. So she can't see without her glasses, so she doesn't even know you're here. I guarantee you. She can hear you, but that's about it. Yeah. So Diana loves the Lord, and we just had a good conversation today. She grew up kind of in a Catholic family, you know, back and forth a little bit. But yeah, and she's like many people that I meet that, you know, want to be baptized. They're like, well, I don't know everything. Well, get in line. Neither do I. I don't know everything either, but we trust the Lord. And so she trusts the Lord today, and wherever that takes her and her family, that's what she's saying today that she's participating in. And so it's pretty awesome.
No, it doesn't matter about the rest. If I got you, Lord, I'm so blessed. On my best day, I'm a child of God. On my worst day, I'm a child of God. Oh, every day is a good day. And you're the reason why. I'm so blessed, I'm
Hey, this is Brittany Frischkorn. Again, loves the Lord and is excited about her journey with Christ. And so we're just excited to partner along with her and her family. It looks like there's a whole line of Frischkorns over here. So that's awesome. We're excited. Gage, give it up for Gage, would you? So I told Gage I watched a video the other day of somebody getting in a baptistry with a black bath bomb in their pocket, and he seems like the kid that would do that, but nothing's coming out, so that's good, and we're grateful. Gage is excited to, again, just publicly profess his faith in Christ, and so we're excited to see what God does with Gage. Amen?
Occasions like this, I like to talk about myself, but today I'm not. I want to talk about Jesus. You ever heard the expression, kill two birds with one stone? If we can use that expression to Jesus when he was walking on the earth, we would have to say, Jesus killed a whole species with one stone. So as Pastor drowns me in front of you, because that's how long I need to be held under here, I'd like to thank you guys for being patient with me. Thank you very much.
Amen. Amen. We love Aaron and his family.
What is your name again? I'm kidding.
Felix.
I'm kidding.
No. Remember the first night that you saw me and Purple Hoodie Girl.
So I met Purple Hoodie Girl at our U Recovery. And the first night she came, she followed me everywhere. She said, Felix, I have a question. Felix, I have a question. I was like, Bobby?
Was he really going to kill you, Bobby?
But ever since then, she's really come a long way. She's working. She's got a job. She's made a decision to live for Christ. And I was asked by family members if I could hold her down just for a little bit longer.
So no problems.
Anyway.
child of God. Oh, every day is a good day, and you're the reason why.
Amen. Hey, I'm glad y'all came again today. You just keep showing up because God's good, isn't he? Amen?
Amen.
Pretty soon, that wall out there with the baptisms, we're going to have to move that to a bigger wall. So we're excited to be part of a church that gets the opportunity to do this often, and so we're grateful for that. Let me pray with you. Father, thank you so much for an opportunity to be again in your presence today as a congregation. Lord, I just pray as we leave this place today that you would keep us warm, you'd keep us safe. But Father, give us the opportunity even today to tell somebody about what you're doing in our lives, what you've done in our lives, and what we think that you're going to continue to do. And we believe that. Father, you are we are just grateful today. We have grateful hearts and thankful hearts. Lord, again, we love you. In Jesus' name, amen. You're dismissed. Hey, don't forget, no student ministry this evening. Stay home, stay warm.